Good morning. Welcome to Clinton United Church on Worldwide Communion Sunday. This morning, we will not be having communion. Kathy has COVID, so that's why I'm here. Not that it's any special occasion. And so I'll be... Yeah, okay, thank you. See if you still want to clap after the service. Now I've forgotten where I was. Oh, so because Kathy's not here, we're not having communion on Worldwide Communion Sunday, so we will do that. Worship and Music Committee is going to talk about that either next week or the week following. That's fine. We'll get there. So Elizabeth and I are taking the service. I'm going to be calling out the hymns, and she'll be doing the difficult things. And guess where we parked this morning? Underneath the sign, exactly, that says you park, you preach. So that's what Elizabeth's going to be doing. So we'll just light the candle and do the call to worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Jesus invites us to come to the table.
God calls us to be part of God's family.
We come to fulfill our deep yearning for God.
We come to seek heaven longing and peace.
The first hymn will be number 395, Come In and Sit Down. Thank you. So the announcements this morning. So this is the acknowledgement screen that we will be showing every Sunday now from going forward. And when Kathy's back, she will announce. She will do that acknowledgement from the pulpit on selected Sundays. The announcements are showing there. We just had our chicken dinner. Thank you for everyone that helped. And there's a list of our upcoming meetings. Worshiping music is this week, outreach is this week. CE, the 11th is next week, right? And then the UCW executive also next week. Coffee Conversations in Christ is October the 6th at 10:30. That's next Thursday. And yes, and everyone is welcome. Oh, that's the Prime Minister's Cell Ministry. Sorry, I'm getting confused. And Stuff the Truck is coming up on October 15th. Come and help out. That's a Saturday morning, I believe. We'll work from 9:30 till noon. And November Nibbles is coming up. That's bakeries and things. November 5th. And coffee time is following the church. We just have one announcement that's a personal one. The flowers in the church today are in remembrance of Weldon Westlake. That's Elizabeth Thorpe Burns' stepfather, who passed away this week after a long battle with Alzheimer's. His celebration of life will be next Saturday, October 7th, in Knollwood Baptist on Cheapside Road in London. There's a 10 o'clock visitation before the service at 11, followed by a luncheon. Please keep your family. Please keep our family in your thoughts and prayers at this time. Now we'll have Pass the Peace, and the choir is singing an anthem this morning. It's not the one that's printed in your paper bulletin, but it'll be a surprise.
turn on. Woo! Exciting. This morning in our learning together, we're going to talk about inheritance. Inheritance is all about what we get, what is given to us. History, it's history. And we can't influence history. We can't change history. We can't change the facts. What we can do from history is learn from it and not repeat the mistakes made. Some inheritance is absolutely horrible. Graveyards found in schools is an example of horrible, evil history. A nation built on colonization to the detriment, annihilation, and extermination of others is horrid. We can't change that history. We can't change the facts. But we can learn from it and we can change the future, because the future belongs to us. As you know, Friday was National Day for Truth and Reconciliation, with the slogan, "Every child matters." Although you and I did not personally abuse or kill Aboriginal children, we are responsible for our response to that. To listen, to include, to prioritize our time, our money, our resources, and to assist with the healing. Now, some inheritance is good, really good. We're proud of what we inherited from our folks, our good looks, our tall stature. And in my family, it's the famous Hearn gene. They can all but me roll their tongue. So try it. Can you roll your tongue? Can you make a little, like I can't show you how to do it. Try it right now. Everybody wants to try this, okay? For those of you that can roll your tongue, congratulations. From those of us who can't, who cares? But in our family, it's a big deal. So inheritance is about what we get, what's given to us, what's handed down. So, perhaps eye color. Well, no perhaps about it. You can't control the color of your eyes. You could have beautiful baby blues. You could have gorgeous browns. You could have gregarious greens. You have no control over your eye color. It's just given to you. People who say, oh, well, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, are talking about how people behave. We're not talking about behavior. It's not naturing. You don't nurture inheritance. It's nature. It is what's given to you. Lots of us will inherit, and we inherit really nice things like jewelry. Jewelry is often given because it's something you can wear every day to remind you of the person, and it is something that's valuable, and it's often handed out. This lovely necklace and my pin and my earrings were given to me by my mother's Avon lady, because she knew I would wear them. So I wear them with pride and think of her every time I do. Some of us inherit money. You may even inherit debt. Not so exciting. Or tangible things like boats, cars, photos, your grandmother's old dishes, whatever those things are. We are in the place of inheriting. And what we inherit, we often hand down to our children and their children and so on and so on. But God calls us all children. God has no grandchildren. Our love for him cannot be handed down. I can't give my faith to my children. My children have to find it themselves. They're on their own journey. So because we are all children of God, we cannot be his grandchildren. He cannot have grandchildren and is not able to pass down. It's a choice each of us has to make. Okay, Jeff, you can leave the next hymn.
The next hymn is Draw the Circle Wide, number 145 in the More Voices, or Words Beyond Screen.
3:21-26. Yet I still dare to hope when I remember this. The faithful love of God never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. And I say to myself, the Lord is my inheritance. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who depend on him, to those who search for him. So it is good to wait quietly for salvation from the Lord.
The psalm this morning is Psalm 67 on page 786 in the hymn book, and with the refrain. Be gracious unto us, O God, and bless us, and let the light of your face shine upon us.
That your ways may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy.
For you judge the people righteously and guide the nations of the earth.
The earth has yielded its harvest, and you, our God, have blessed us.
Your blessing.
Timothy chapter 1, verses 1-7 and 13-14. This letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be the apostle of Christ Jesus. I have been sent out to tell others about the life he has promised through faith in Jesus Christ. I am writing to Timothy, my dear son. May God the Father in Christ Jesus our Lord give you grace, mercy, and peace. Timothy, I thank God for you, the God I serve with a clear conscience, just as my ancestors did. Night and day, I constantly remember you in my prayers. I long to see you again, for I remember your tears when we parted, and I will be filled with joy when we are together again. I remember your genuine faith, for you share the faith that first your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice had, and I know that same faith continues strong in you. This is why I remind you to fan into flames the spiritual gift of God that he gave you when I laid my hands on you. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. Hold on to the pattern of wholesome teaching you learned from me, a pattern shaped by the faith and love that you have in Christ Jesus. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, who lives within us, carefully guard the precious truth that has been entrusted to you. And our last reading is from Luke chapter 17, 5-6. The apostle said to the Lord, "Show us how to increase our faith." And the Lord answered, "If you have faith, even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'May you be uprooted and be planted in the sea,' and it would obey you."
The next hymn is number 288, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
We got the word yesterday that Kathy had COVID, course, the phone call came to our house, M&P chair. Jeff's the chair of the board. So there was talk about try to find somebody. Well, we live in a community where four of the churches around us are without ministers. So people were busy. And so I said, well, maybe I can do this. And when I looked at the notes that Kathy had, it was the exact same scripture from the Bible that we are going to have read at my stepfather's service. Now, they say there isn't a God, but I don't think that's coincidence. So my mom and I had been discussing those passages, and that helped me greatly. So when Kathy's slide came, I thought, okay, yep, can do that. I'm going to add this little area here to it because my mom and I had been discussing it. So I'm going to preach Kathy's sermon with a twist of Elizabeth. And so as she would begin, let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be pleasing and honorable to you, dear Lord. Amen. Each child in each generation chooses faith or disbelief. Faith is not an inheritance, it is a choice. I like this quote. I've never seen it before, but I was glad Kathy put it there. Because at some point in your life, you have to choose to believe or not believe. Faith cannot be handed on down to you, as we talked about in the children's story. I can't say, here's my faith. I'm inheriting it to you. It's a personal journey. I had a friend at university, and during lots of discussions, she said to me, well, you know, I've decided not to decide about that right now. And then I looked at her and I said, so you have decided. You've decided not to decide. You've still made a decision. You're still making a choice. My husband, Jeff, spoke at his mother's funeral 17 years ago. And the thing that I remember about him talking, his whole speech, is that he talked about the fact that his mom said to him, you have to make a decision at some point, Jeff. You can't serve two masters. You can't ride two horses with one bottom. I'm sure she would never have said that. I added that. And he'd chosen to believe. And that this decision had affected everything. How he conducted his business, how he spent his money, how he treated other people, how he raised his children, the partner he'd chosen to spend life with, and how he spends his free time. It's a choice. So why would you choose to believe when the world tells you so much it can't possibly be right? Well, Lamentation gives us reasons. Pardon for sin. Christ came, he died for our sin. When I get before the Lord, I'm taken there by Christ, who presents me faultless. I'm perfect. Who wouldn't want that? That's an incredible gift. It's a get-out-of-jail-free card. Therefore, because I am blameless, because my sins are taken away, I'm forgiven. Oh, and the power of forgiveness. If you've ever been in any kind of counseling, you go and you talk with someone and you realize you need to forgive people who've done something wrong. Because you forgive them, it doesn't mean that they didn't do anything wrong. It means you're released from the power that's had over your life. I spent a lot of time in the last 2 weeks on an Alzheimer ward called Memory Lane. And every time you went outside the hall, into the hall, you would meet all these poor, tortured, mad people, really. And there was one little lady, I don't know what she ever did in her life, but she would walk around, and when she'd see you, she would beg you to please, please forgive me. I'll never forget her. She was so tortured, I don't know what she ever did, but I would hold her hand, and I would say, I forgive you, it's okay. I really, really forgive you. I'd say it 3 or 4 times, and then her face, the peace, the release that she'd been forgiven, at least for a time for her. With us, we're released always. We're blameless. That gives you such peace. Peace that endures, not just for one day like it did for this little lady or for a minute or so, but for everything, for our entire life. We can relax. We can bloom where we're planted. We're forgiven. We've got peace. I read a book a few years ago. Well, I do read books other times, but and in the book they were talking about zoos. Lots of people hate zoos. They think zoos are horrible for animals, poor animals, wild animals that are meant to be free. But this person was talking about the fact that for some animals, zoos are wonderful. And the reason is animals in the wild spend all the time trying to find dinner. They're all about survival all the time. And in a zoo, they realize, hey, I got a nice place. I don't have to pay for it. They don't have to work or find. They give me dinner. They give it regularly. There's perks. There's other people I can hang out with. We don't have to do anything but lie here and enjoy life. Sort of like retired life, I guess. Some animals don't like it, and if they don't, zoos are diligent about releasing those animals back to the wild. But for a lot of animals, they absolutely enjoy it because they have a peace that endureth. You and I have that same peace. What else do we have if we're with the Lord? We have His presence to cheer us and to guide us. Every service, what do we start with? The Lord be with you. Exactly. He's with us. Psalm 23:4. Yea, though I walk through the shadow of the valley of death, I will fear no evil. Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Or how about, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You're going to show me. You're going to guide me. You're going to cheer me. What about Psalm 91? And He will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun. Is that not cheerful? And hold you in the palm of His hand, guiding. He promises you strength for today. For today. Give us this day our daily bread. Don't go down the road one day at a time. I think Christ definitely had to live like that. If you knew that whole crucifixion and that was coming, I don't even want to think about that. Day for today. Strength for today. Psalm 121, 1 to 2. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. They're huge. Can you imagine making both? Incredible strength, our daily bread. What else does He promise? Bright hope for tomorrow. You know, suicide victims kill themselves because they have no hope. And they say children in jail, that are put in jail, suffer more than adults because they can't see the future. They can only see the immediate, and it's horrible, and they're stuck in this little prison cell, and they don't realize that perhaps one day they will be released. A friend of mine just became a grandparent, and on her Facebook post, she quoted her father's favorite hymn. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives, but greater still the calm assurance this child can face on certain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. That's pretty bright. Bright, bright, bright. And when you have pardon from sin and a peace that endureth, my brain is sort of fried. Presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today, and bright hope for tomorrow. I do better if I sing the hymn. Blessings. Blessings are all mine. So I'm blessed over and over and over in my life because the Lord loves me and wants to bless me. Then, my life, hopefully, if I let the Lord use it, can be a blessing to others. So God can bless others. And on and on and on through the generations, the blessings can continue on. 2 Timothy says, I remember your genuine faith, for you share the faith that first filled your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I know that same faith continues strong in you. And on and on. Hebrews 6:12, imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. Many go before you and I, and they have been a really good example. They've shown us how to do it. We can't inherit their faith again, but they can show us how to do it. So Kathy wanted us to have a look at this plaque. This plaque is dedicated to the parking lot extension. And lists a lot of people who use their money, who are you kidding, to help build the parking lot we have. When our two churches joined years ago, we needed parking. So when those two homes, I think there were two, was there two or one? I don't know, Gord's not here to ask. But anyway, the properties that were beside us came up for sale. We bought that property and made a parking lot. So these people on the plaque, which includes you and I, because we are the congregation at large, literally and figuratively lay the foundation. Their decisions to believe and follow Christ affected and still affects how they spend their money, how they spend their time, what they believe, how they raise their children, and on and on. Timothy 2:1-14, guard through the Holy Spirit who dwells in us the treasure which has been entrusted to you. We have had wonderful people who have shown us how to do it. And we have to treasure that and entrust it. I'm going to talk about my Sunday school teacher. When I was a little girl, my mom and dad went to a Baptist church. And the Baptists certainly teach you your Bible. It's very important to that particular denomination. And so in Sunday school, we had Sunday school an hour before church. And during church, when the minister was preaching, we got to go downstairs and have some more Sunday school. So they kept it really, really fun. But one of the things that really made an impression on me was my Sunday school teacher said that God knew the number of hairs that were on my head. Now, I was a girl that had very long, long blonde hair back then, and it got brushed, right? If you're going to have long hair, you got to take care of it. And every night we'd brush, and then there'd be hairs in the brush that had come out, and there'd be some on my shoulders and whatnot. And I was like, really? He knows how many, even the ones that fall out? You bet, she said. Matthew 10:30, but the very hairs on your head are all numbered. And Luke 12:7, indeed, the very hairs on your head are numbered. Do not fear, you are more valuable than sparrows. If he cares about my hair, even on a bad hair day, I am a personal concern. He is personally concerned about me and you. You're a child too. And the Bible goes on to say, if you have faith as tiny as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by your roots and be planted in the sea, and it'll obey you. If you have that faith, if you decide for that faith, it comes down to decision time. Remember, faith is caught rather than taught. So, if you haven't, or if you need to do it again, go get yourself some of that. Go catch it. It's not inherited. It's a choice. I believe Louise usually plays a lovely gift for us of music while we think about the many wonderful gifts the Lord has given to us. join me in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for a time to be together. Thank you for all the good blessings. Lord, we pray for Kathy, our minister, as she suffers with COVID. Be with her. Help her to rest and recover. And all members of our congregation who are unwell. Lord, we pray for those who are in need, those in horrific civil violence, those in war, those in flooding or weather situations that are destructive. Lord, we pray for those in counseling who have to do the horrible work of talking about the pain and forgiving and working through it. Lord, we pray for us as a group. Help us to do what it is you want us to do. Thank you for giving us a free ticket. Thank you for giving us choice. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to work in our lives as we repeat the words that your Son taught us.
Our closing hymn, as printed in the on the screen, is number 580, Faith of Our Fathers.
Thank you.
Kathy has some eloquent words to send us out into the world. I'll just say, go now and take your faith out into the world and live as God intended us to live.